You're listening to highlights from The David Feldman Show, heard nationwide on Pacifica Radio, or as a podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, and now YouTube. Please subscribe to this channel. For more information, go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Thank you for listening.
The David Feldman Radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
I believe in us.
I believe in us. I'm so happy today. All we get is bad news coming out of Washington, D.C. My listeners are depressed. The July 4th weekend is coming up. It's barbecue time. And finally, some good news. Finally. Now, according to the Government Accountability Project, foodborne illnesses sicken more than 76 million Americans each year. They are responsible for 725,000 hospitalizations and more than 5,000 deaths each year. But don't let that affect your barbecue, because Donald Trump, I don't like him, but he's finally doing something good. I knew if we waited long enough, he would finally do something good. There's news coming out of Washington, D.C. that Donald Trump's Department of Agriculture is ready to implement a new regulation called the Modernization of Swine Slaughter Inspection, MSSI. For more on this, we are joined by Amanda Hill. She is the director of the Government Accountability Project's Food Integrity Campaign, and she joins us from Washington, D.C. Thank you for being with us, Amanda.
Thank you so much for having me.
Well, I cannot wait to fire up the grill and serve pork, because our leader, Donald Trump, is modernizing the way we slaughter swine. This is great.
I'm glad you're excited, because I'm afraid you might be a little off. I think that we might need to correct your assumption about what Donald Trump believes modern to be, because the only thing modern here is that there's nothing modern here. There's no modern here. So it's actually just privatization. Privatization, that's been around for a long time, and that notion that that'd be good for us has been around for a long time. But we know time and time again, especially in the world of food safety, that we don't want to let these industries regulate themselves, because when they do, they don't do the greatest of jobs. In fact, even with regulations, things aren't great. So this modernization, which is privatization, I don't know. I'm a little concerned about it personally.
The Modernization of Swine Slaughter Inspection Rule, according to foodwhistleblower.org, that is your website, they are asking pig inspectors to inspect 83 pounds of pork per second. What does that mean?
It's a calculation based on one of these hogs. They're not little tiny things that are streaming down a conveyor belt. These are enormous animals, but roughly 250 pounds. And these inspectors are slaughtering those pigs at 1,300 hogs per hour.
Okay, so we were being a little cute and funny here, but obviously right. we have a serious problem with hog inspection. I don't eat pigs. I'm a borderline vegan, so I don't eat the stuff. I don't know anything about slaughtering pigs. I know that pigs are the closest thing we have to humans. I don't mean to depress anybody, but they know they're about to be slaughtered. You can hear them screaming. They make great pets. They're almost as smart as dogs. But that's not why you're here today. You didn't come on to preach veganism, unless you did. Pork, people love bacon. People love bacon. They're completely detached from the pig. Bacon is just something that shows up in your sandwich. We don't know where it comes from. It just tastes great, according to people. But it comes from pigs, right? And there are slaughterhouses. Forget the plight of pigs. From what I'm reading over at foodwhistleblower.org, there's a new regulation being considered by the Department of Agriculture that would end up putting toenails and garbage into our pork products because they're trying to speed up the slaughter of pigs and keep the inspectors overworked. Is that essentially what's going on?
They are currently overworked. The new rule would have them out of work. I mean, this is an opportunity for the plants to take over their own regulatory processes. This is an opportunity for them to make the decisions about what gets in your bacon. And if that's toenails, then that's the consequence of going fast, and they want to go fast. And they'll, let's just say you do eat meat. If you are a meat eater, you're going to be hurt by this too, because you're now going to be getting a subpar product, a product that was not as good as you used to have it, and you're going to be paying the exact same price for it. So There's no benefit to you whether you're, you know, a meat eater or not. If you don't eat pigs, and a lot of people don't, and a lot of people who are interested in seeing this rule stopped are doing so out of animal welfare concerns. It's smart to take a stand against this rule. It's smart for you to say, you know what, I don't eat pig, but I don't want to see pigs slaughtered in this fashion. And don't want to get too graphic, but
go ahead.
You know, it's not, if you've seen some of the undercover video of this, what happens in the process of the slaughter function? So you have to render the animal insensible. So just basically what we're saying is knock them out. And in a lot of cases, that's done through some sort of electrical charge that will give the pig a seizure and then sort of knock them out so that the pig isn't aware that they're being shackled and having their throat slit and scalded. Mm-hmm. So imagine a situation that's so fast, it's just so fast, moving so fast, that the pigs aren't properly shocked. That means they're going to get shackled and have their throat slit and potentially be scalded alive as a consequence of this high speed. So this isn't just a meat eater problem because you don't want to have poop in your bacon. This is a situation for anybody who cares about animal welfare as well.
How we treat animals is a pretty good barometer of how we treat each other. And they can't even execute prisoners in this country benignly. They can't even figure out the cocktail to create a painless death for inmates when we do capital punishment. So
who do you think they've got committing these gross deaths? Who do they have on these slaughter lines? They probably don't look like you and me. They're probably folks that people don't pay much attention to at all. And I'm talking about, by and large, an immigrant workforce. A lot of that workforce is not documented. And so these people who are witnessing, who are in the best position to stop these atrocities, to stop poop from getting in your bacon, to stop the toenails and the hair from getting in your bacon, are the people who have no voice. And that's not an accident. They didn't put those people there by accident. They know that they'll never speak up. And they, you know what, they don't have a lot of whistleblower rights. They can't speak up freely. You know, when they witness these kinds of things, like sick pigs getting put into the slaughter system, if they dare speak up, they risk being fired.
You're saying that Big Ag, it's in their best interest to hire frightened, undocumented workers who will keep their mouths shut because the Big Ag has something on these workers, and if they speak up, they'll be sent back to where they came from.
Precisely. Let's make no mistake about it. They don't want people to speak up about what they see, and they don't want those undercover videos being made of what's happening, because the entire industry is predicated on secrecy. Because if you knew what was happening, you wouldn't buy into it, and if you bought into it, you would do so at a lesser degree, and that's fact of the year. And let me tell you what they do to these folks. These, you know, it's like, who are the people who bring you these animal proteins? Like, what's their life like?
You're saying that it's not about the wall. It's not about keeping Mexicans out. The problem is a company like Hormel. Who are some of the butchers that do this?
JBS is a big one, but you hit the nail on the head with Hormel. I mean, they're the ones that are using the pilot program for this high-speed slaughter rule right now. I mean, they're reaping the benefit of it right now.
Donald Trump says we need to build a wall. We need to keep the Mexicans and the Guatemalans out. And we have ICE from immigration rounding up people. But we really know where the undocumented workers are. They're on the slaughterhouse line, right?
That's where you'll find them, right where they're supposed to be.
That's okay with Trump because that's helping his friends in Big Ag. We need frightened people in this country illegally so that we can treat them like slaves. That's part of the plan. It's not an accident. It's part of the plan.
That's it. That's what's happening. And those are the people, these frightened people who contact us. They want help. And their stories are the same. If I do this, if I come forward, not only will I get retaliated against for doing so, but the people that I am friends with, I'm family with, inside these plants, they too will get retaliated. But wait, it gets worse if I do tell the truth, if I do speak up, if I do go public. I will never work in my small rural community again. It's a lot of weight to bear for somebody who's clearly unwanted by this president, but he does want them because he wants them to do this slave labor. He needs them to carry on this farce, that this is a benign industry. I think if you knew it was happening, if you knew it was going inside of those walls, I think you'd think twice about purchasing those products.
I know that most people are smarter than I am, and they're saying, David, move on. We get it. But you don't hear this. You do not hear this in the newspaper. Well, you don't hear anything in a newspaper. You don't hear it on the radio. You do not hear it on television. You don't read about this. This is never discussed. And I've been saying this for years, and I'm going to just repeat this one more time. Because this is the immigration issue. The immigration issue is, it is not that people are coming to this country and doing the jobs that we could be doing. It's not even they're doing the jobs that we don't want to do. They are doing the jobs that we can't get hired to do because we're American citizens, and American citizens have rights. Because American citizens have rights and they speak up for themselves, there are jobs that have to be given to undocumented workers in this country because they're the only ones who will keep their mouths shut.
Correct.
And that is a business plan. That's not an accident. That is a business plan. So if you were to look at an assembly line, do you call them assembly lines, a slaughterhouse line? What do you call these things?
A slaughter line.
If you look at a slaughter line, this might be an unfair question, but what percentage of them would be undocumented?
That I'm not sure of, but I can tell you that the vast majority of them are from an immigrant workforce. The speed is what kills you. The speed is the problem, and that's exactly what this new rule seeks to unregulate. It takes the chains off of speed. And we're looking at 30,000 motions per shift. That's the average slaughter line worker. And he or she is now completely unprotected. There is no regulatory watchdog watching over the line, making sure it works anymore. That's gone. So this is the secrecy that has been enhanced.
Are there inspectors on every slaughterhouse floor?
Yes, there are. Yeah, that's by law. They can't get rid of the federal meat inspector entirely, but they can take his or her job duties and hand it over to the companies themselves in large proportion. And again, that's what the rule is all about. It's make no mistake. Nothing about this rule is going to make your food safer. I mean, it's a regulation designed to deregulate. You don't hear about those often, but this is exactly that. This is giving these big giant corporations more ability to put profit over public health and less stringent oversight.
A move towards self-inspection. As if I were to walk onto a slaughterhouse floor, will I always see a USDA inspector from the Department of Agriculture?
You should. You should, yes. They're there by law. Yes.
By law.
Courtesy of the jungle, right? So right. Upton Sinclair has brought you meat inspection modern meat inspection as we know it, not modern meat inspection as Trump knows it.
Every slaughterhouse floor has a government inspector. There's no such thing yet as self-inspection where Hormel inspects itself. There's always a government inspector on the floor.
Correct.
Are they moving towards self-inspection? Is that what they're...
Oh, yeah. Yes, yeah. That's the goal, right? I mean, let them regulate themselves. We'll save some taxpayer money and everyone will go on and be happy and we'll all sink to the same level as China and keep those same sorts of standards as our own when we've always held our standards so much higher. Now we'll just forget about it. It's the Wild West. It's the Wild West now. I have trouble almost talking about this subject because it almost belies the truth that's very apparent that things aren't so great right now. Things aren't wonderful now. So that the thought that Trump is going to make a bad thing worse is outrageous to me. And everybody needs to be paying attention to this. Everybody needs to be talking about this. Anybody who eats hot dogs for 4th of July ought to care about where their hot dog comes from. Because the likelihood is the only reason it doesn't have a big old piece of hair or toenail in it is because of a federal inspector who's doing his or her job. And that's who you want to thank this 4th of July. So to eliminate them from the game, and I'm not saying this new rule is going to completely eliminate federal inspection. I'm not. We are walking that path. We are going down that path. We are headed toward a deregulated food industry. And even if that's many years from now, we don't want to be eating until that point toenails. We want to say at this point that we are not willing to accept less as our new standard. We're not there yet. We're not, as a country, we're willing to spend some money on food inspection because everybody eats. It doesn't matter if you're a farmer or a financier. Everybody eats and everybody deserves to serve their children safe and wholesome food, right? That was a right we all sort of enjoyed. Well, you can't let Trump take that away or any politician take that away because the only thing that's benefiting, the only person in the room who stands to benefit from this are the greedy corporations that I think have done quite enough and they've hurt quite a few. So it's time to stop giving them more handouts and start taking care of ourselves.
The inspectors work for the government. They're not undocumented workers. Why aren't they speaking up?
And they do. They do. Well, you're welcome to check out what they have to say at foodwhistleblower.org. You can review their affidavits. Whistleblowers, very brave whistleblowers, spoke up. But the reality of the situation is the plants have so much power in this scenario. The plants, the private part, have so much power that they even influence the federal government to do their will and their bidding. So it takes a really special, brave USDA inspector to come forward and present his information to the public. It's an amazing thing. And I have to say, as a whistleblower lawyer, these public employees, the government inspectors who speak up, they have more rights than the private employees, the plant workers. They have many more rights under the whistleblower protection.
Let's get to that in a second.
Sure.
Tell me about the inspectors. Who pays their salary? Taxpayers or Hormel?
Taxpayers pay their salaries, yeah.
They work for the taxpayers.
They do. They do. They are civil servants.
Are they frightened of the owners of the slaughterhouse? Do they show up every day to the same slaughterhouse? Are they kind of like the factory workers? They have shifts where they're inspecting each day?
Yeah. They're not the factory workers. They're not the plant workers. They are third party. They do have power to stop things and to regulate. However, the nature of this industry is that the plants have accumulated much of the power that the inspectors once had, and they are able to bully inspectors through backroom dealing, and these plant managers are in cahoots with people at the district office and the government and inspectors.
ICE has its own union.
Right.
Do the inspectors have a union?
The inspectors do have a union, and their union absolutely supports them and their ability to speak up. But I have to be clear to you that this is not an all things equal game. I mean, these inspectors are fighting an uphill battle. They have been losing clout and losing their strength and their fight against the incredible, powerful lobby of the industries. These industries are no joke. Everybody wants to talk about national security like that's the only thing going on. But in the United States, we have incredibly powerful food industries in the meat. The animal protein industry is a major player with an incredibly strong lobby, and they bully the U.S. government's federal inspectors. I'm not saying every federal inspector can't do his or her job effectively, but I'm saying everyone has felt the effect of the growing power of this lobby. They know it well.
I'm all about finding a scapegoat. We are talking about slaughterhouses. As long as we're butchering, let's find a scapegoat. What about the union? What about the union? Why isn't the union speaking up for these inspectors and portraying them as the victims here? Because it seems to me, if you're an inspector and you're taking taxpayer dollars, you have an obligation to report undocumented workers. If you see something, say something. So if we want to rattle the cage, why not blame the inspectors?
I would not. I'm never going to say it. I you know, in these troubled Trump times, you know, the inclination is to say to hell with government and I don't want to be a part of it.
I agree with you.
I'm saying the opposite.
I agree with you. I agree with you.
You've got to stand with your government and stand when you agree to engage in this conversation about this rule and what Trump is doing, you're saying that I want my government back. I want my regulations working for me. I want my inspectors to be heard and heeded. I want to be a part of my government. And not to say, you know, oh, well, you know, the government is failing. They're not doing enough. They're not looking out for us. Woe is me. My taxpayer dollars aren't being well spent. That's bull. That's absolute crap. I mean, these people are, I know these people. So do I sound like I'm connected a little to the problem? I am, because I know the individuals who are the players in the game. And I know they're doing an amazing job, and they're standing up for your family's food safety. They're standing up for animals, right? They don't work at PETA, right? But they're standing up for animals and losing their jobs to do it. I had a meat inspector named Jim Schreier. He blew the whistle on inhumane handling and conscious pigs being shackled. Blew the whistle. We worked with him, and he was able to keep his job and change the behavior of Tyson in that case. And it takes one person with an incredible amount of resolve to make it happen. And sometimes it takes a team of lawyers behind that person to make it happen. But we are making it happen. And you know, the blame is not on the federal meat inspectors. They're doing a hell of a job. They're trying so hard.
I get that. I'm just talking about public relations, getting things done, expectations. I don't expect Hormel to be anything other than what they slaughter, pigs. They're going to always be that way.
Right.
You turn to the government to take them on. And if the government isn't taking them on, you have to hold them accountable. I know that the food inspectors are like the police. You know, they're trying to protect us. They're trying to protect us. But I also know that the police turn a blind eye out of convenience and laziness, and the police are very dangerous. And as a taxpaying citizen, I just wonder if it's more efficient and effective to start attacking the USDA, because they are responsive. They're the ones who actually care about this stuff. Hormel doesn't care. When the stock market crashes, you blame the SEC. When the banks crash, you blame the FDIC. It starts with blaming the government.
I'm not a USDA apologist. I'm really not. I mean, mm-hmm. I think the USDA has a bit of a problem. It would appear they are bought and paid for. It would appear by circumstances surrounding this rule, the revolving door, that there's a lot of question marks mm-hmm. on the end of that sentence. USDA is not doing everything it could or should do to protect
What would happen if I called ICE? And I said, there are undocumented workers in the slaughterhouse. I know this for a fact. Go in there. What would happen?
I don't know. I don't do, you know, immigration law. You know, I'm definitely aware and concerned about migrant workers and their plight and their role in all of this. But when it comes to the administration of ICE, I don't know anything about
it. I'm a vegetarian. I don't know the difference between eating toenails and eating a dead body. I really don't. Part of me, when you were saying this, I'm thinking, suppose we give pigs mani-pedis and use their toenail clippings and keep them alive, put their feces. I'm being serious. Put their feces.
No, I think it's a good question. It's a good question.
If people you're willing to eat their feces, go ahead. I'm serious. I'd rather have people eating hog feces than the actual hog.
It's a good question. I've got nothing to hide here. I don't eat pigs. I never would. I just don't. I'd say that I don't eat pigs.
You know, I'm a comedian. Every comic does this. They all do this bit and they get a huge laugh. They say, I love the taste of hot dogs. You know, they say it has toenail clippings and pig snout and feces and cockroaches. Fire it up. Yummy. Gets a big laugh and people cheer because you know what? This is America. Most people don't care what they eat. So that's the first problem.
You have a couple of few things there, and I want to address everyone because I think everyone is important. Again, so if it doesn't matter whether you eat pigs or not, you should be concerned about the way treated and if they should die in the most humane and ethical way. That's just or you're an abolitionist and you think they should never die at all. In which case, this really isn't your issue because you just, you know, hey, I don't think that. The other thing, though, that I think is important is something you mentioned about Americans don't care about what they eat. Americans have been told not to care about what they eat because everything's safe is everything's fine. Everything's regulated and inspected. We're sort of taught that, or anybody, at least Gen X and older, you just think, well, the government does that for you. And so we've been conditioned to think our food is safe when in reality, we're deregulating these industries and the same food we used to bank on is not as safe anymore. Our USDA stamp doesn't mean what it meant 10 or 15 or 20 or 30 years ago. There's a lot less regulation going into our regulatory apparatus. Also, just one little thing to sort of bring up here is that everybody generally dismisses hot dog as being lips and ass. I mean, that's what you're eating. So who gives a crap if you get a little toenail and feces in it? It's gross anyway. Well, that's fine. If you know what you're eating, if you know you're eating scrapple and you know what that's made of and you pay a price for scrapple or hot dogs that makes sense to you, then that's a fair bargain. But what if you bought premium bacon? What if you thought you had something good and that was of a higher quality when in fact it's just lips and ass? That's not fair. That's not what you bargained for. That's not an okay scenario as a consumer. So there's a lot of gray in the conversation, but at the edges of it, we see something that's very clear, that if we're going to continue on as a society that will eat meat, we should have meat processed in a way that is consistent with our commonly held values and beliefs. And that means to the way that the animal was treated, to the way it was packaged, labeled, and sold to you at the store. It matters every way in between. Is it consistent? Does it have integrity?
By the way, lips and ass was the original name of my radio show. It's a bad joke. Lips and ass.
I wish it was. I think it's from the movie The Great Outdoors. John Candy. He's cooking hot dogs, and anyway, they were like, "Don't you know that's just lips and ass?" It's good stuff. It's quality movie making.
Yeah, so. I also think the problem is Anthony Bourdain. I'm being glib here, but I kind of mean this. You turn on CNN and the Food Channel, and you have these chefs traveling all over the world eating exotic food. Suddenly, you're being taught to eat grasshopper, and we're being told that we could feed the entire world if Americans will learn to eat cockroaches. Americans are being taught not to care if there are cockroaches in their hot dogs anymore. Everything is edible. And it's good for the planet if everything is edible.
I think if we're open to eating insects as a protein source versus a pig, then my sensibilities are with go ahead and eat cockroaches. But the problem, it's not that we're okay with eating bugs. Are we comfortable eating superbugs? And superbugs is a lot bigger concern to me. So
the microscopic superbugs kill, yes. Right.
That, and Anthony Bourdain, I don't think, has anything to do with that so much,
right.
You know. But I get your point, and the superbugs that I'm most concerned about. If we're looking at factory farming, if we're really evaluating this scenario, we have to be not just afraid of the superbugs. We have to really look at zoonotic transfer of the jump to swine flu or something. We have these controlled animal operations with all of these pigs and the opportunity for a zoonotic jump, it's just so right in our faces. So if we're going to play this game, we have to know that there's a whammy card in the deck. you know, and and it's not just the super bugs that are part and parcel to a lot of our poultry operations, well, and swine as well. It's this opportunity for the next big killer. The next big thing could very well be a creature of the factory farm. So we better, again, whether you eat meat or not, you better start caring about the way that these places are operating and how they're regulated and who's got the oversight power in all of this.
Zoonotic jump?
Or transfer, like a flu that goes from pigs to people, flu that goes from birds to people. So it's a jump, it's a hop. And it comes when you have people in close proximity and animals in large concentrations. So it's the petri dish. Like, we need to regulate that petri dish. We need to have all hands on deck, and everybody who is in a position to do something to promote public health needs to be on top of factory farming. It's an incredibly important part of food systems and how we're going to feed ourselves in the future. If it wasn't for climate change, all we'd be talking about is food systems, because the truth is, like, we've got to feed a growing population, and what will that look like?
Right.
And does it include pigs? Does it include pigs? Do you think it includes pigs? I don't think it includes pigs. For some reason, everybody's eating pigs. I don't think it's a great idea. Hey, there you have it, right? Like, to each their own, I want the right captain steering the ship.
Right.
I believe that that captain is our government, and I do believe that we, the people, need to take part and participate and own our government, you know?
Right.
And tell Trump no. No, Trump. I don't want shit in my food. No thanks.
Right.
Just tell him.
We're going to end on telling people how to sign your petition, who to call, and what to do. Pigs. Two of the world's major religions have outlawed the eating of pigs. We get the flu every year. Where does it come from?
Well, I mean, it's microbial, and it changes. It's a kind of a, my understanding, I'm not a professional influenza expert or even somebody who remembers much of my public health days studying flu. It's a combination of different microbes. The way we create the flu shot is predicting what will be in the flu.
What animal gives us the flu?
Different animals have their own flus, their own flu strains. And sometimes those flu strains merge to create a super influenza.
Primarily, the flu that hits humans comes from pigs?
Swine flu. I'm not positive how much of the current flu is swine flu, or, you know, to what percentage versus bird flu. That's not my area.
I used to work for Bill Maher's show, and I kind of did some research on this, and I found out that most flus come from, I'm not trying to be disgusting here or racist, from the Chinese farmers sleeping with their pigs. Not sexual. I'm not trying to make a joke.
Yeah, sleeping. That's the zoonotic transfer, yeah.
Yeah, they sleep in the same room with these pigs. And
that's absolutely right, yeah. You know that we opened up exports with China, right?
Yes.
Nice, right? That sits well. Like, I don't know, like, what I'm more afraid of, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Trump deregulating the pork industry or just opening the doors for Chinese chicken, which is exactly what you said, exactly what you just said.
Don't eat pig and don't sleep with pigs. That's my...
Don't cuddle your chicken either. Don't eat it and don't cuddle the chickens. Like, yeah. Well, we live in a crazy world, David, and so much going on. There's so much for you to care about. Like, why would you care about a pork chop? Well, if you don't see it as a pork issue, see it as a deregulation thing. You know,
yeah.
Take a stand against deregulation.
I hope you'll come back, because I want to talk about ag gag rules and how the whole food industry is predicated on our not knowing anything. Because if we knew, we'd stop. I don't buy into the premise of big ag, so I'm a vegetarian. I'm a vegetarian because I don't approve of the way we treat our animals. I don't approve of the way we treat our farmers. I don't approve of the way we treat our farm workers or the people who work the kill lines. I will not ingest any of that stuff. I don't want it inside of me. I don't want to be a part of it. And if you want to save the planet, stop eating bacon. Because the amount of water it takes to feed these pigs, the amount of food that has to be fed to these pigs, the amount of energy that goes in to fattening up these pigs. They are disgusting animals. There's a reason we call pigs pigs, because they're disgusting. The excrement from the pigs gets into our water and poisons us. Pigs are as close to human beings In fact, pigs are closer to humans than Donald Trump is. So just stop eating bacon. It's not delicious. You think it's delicious. It's not. Become a vegan. Become a vegetarian. Or at least one day a week. Stop already with this nonsense. You could drive a 32-wheel truck, and if you gave up meat, you'd be having less of a carbon footprint. That's the truth. If you gave up meat, you could keep a 1964 Impala idling all day, and you'd still have less of a carbon footprint.
Well, thanks again. It's been really great talking to you, and I'm obviously very, very passionate about these issues and enjoy the opportunity and the platform. So, you know, thanks. I have to, you know, echo all of your sentiments about the carbon footprint. I think something like an 8-ounce steak is the equivalent of driving 32 miles. So when you ask yourself, you know, what am I doing for the environment, think about what you're eating and how that affects the environment as well. But I do want to just do one quick plug for pigs, right? Because it's not that they're so dirty that there are prohibitions against eating them. It's that they are so much alike. I believe there's some good scholarship on that. So when we think about killing pigs, we should consider the species, but also consider the workers, too, who are in this scenario dirt, which is to say they are the matter that's out of place. They are the disposable aspect. They are as disposable as the pigs. So when you evaluate the industry, look at the people that they've chosen to do the dirty work, to do the work of killing, to do the dangerous job of slaughter. So none of that is an accident. We just need to, as a community, turn a critical eye to what's happening in the animal agricultural industry. Certainly don't want to walk away from it as far as a country, because our regulatory power is our currency in this model. So we don't want to pull out of it just because we're sickened by it, or it doesn't make us feel good, or we don't eat meat. So
the mission statement of my show is to inform, not to overwhelm. People are getting enraged, but it's overwhelming, because most people aren't going to become vegan. Most people aren't going to become vegetarians. Most people aren't going to have a meatless Monday. So they need to do something. You have to do something. Give them one thing to do to cut through the clutter, to clench their fists, stomp their feet, and spend 2 minutes so they don't feel overwhelmed and they're taking control of their country. What can they do right now so they feel that they're not drowning in a sea of information?
The most important thing that you can do, in my mind, is listen to the people who are trying to warn you of the catastrophes that are coming in our food system.
Well, that's not good enough. No. There's a petition. Okay. There's a Hang on for one second. There's got to be somebody to call. There's got to be a petition. There's got to be a website to go to. They have to take action. So what do they do?
If you want to take action, you can join us at foodwhistleblower.org. And all kinds of opportunities for action.
Foodwhistleblower.org. Do they call the White House? Do they call the Department of Agriculture? Do they call the USDA? Is there a petition to sign? Because Mulvaney, the budget director, wants to get this regulation into play where they're going to speed up the assembly lines or the slaughterhouse lines. So who are they supposed to call to stop this regulation?
You want to join on to our petition. You want to sign up at foodwhistleblower.org. You'll see that you can click there and sign our petition. Let President Trump and the USDA know that you're not okay with this rule.
I want all my listeners to go to foodwhistle.org.
Whistleblower.
Foodwhistleblower.
Yeah.
Food whistle is what happens when I eat a Taco Bell. Foodwhistleblower. Sorry. Believe me, you have no idea how well-behaved I was with you. Foodwhistleblower.org. Go to foodwhistleblower.org, give them money, and sign their petition, and learn about how the Trump administration is abusing USDA inspectors and wants 1,300 hogs per hour to move down the processing lines so that you don't see the feces and the toenail clippings in your bacon. Thank you. You'll come back, Amanda Hitt?
Yes, it's been really great. Thank you so much.
Great. Amanda Hitt is
I'll come back.
Thank you. Amanda Hitt is the director of the Government Accountability Project's Food Integrity Campaign. We didn't even get to the work she's done on Pink Slime and ABC and whistleblowing, and find out more by going to foodwhistleblower.org. Thank you for your time.
Thanks so much.
You're listening to Highlights from The David Feldman Show, heard nationwide on Pacifica Radio, or as a podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, and now YouTube. Please subscribe to this channel. For more information, go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Thank you for listening.
The David Feldman Radio Program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.